There is no question whatsoever that agencies of the United States government are withholding UFO information.
Government should make public all of its records on this or any other subject.
People here are still afraid to talk. They're afraid they're going to get, blown away if they say anything.
From the boundaries of the universe to the depth of your soul, embark on a journey through the unknown and unexplained as we explore mysteries, magic, and miracles.
Hello, I'm Patrick Macnee. For those who study the phenomenon of UFOs, the question isn't whether they exist or not, it's how much the government knows about their existence. The answer? Probably a lot more than the government admits.
In 1947, something crashed in a remote part of New Mexico. After a rancher brought pieces of the wreckage to the Roswell Army Air Base, an official press release stated that it was a flying saucer. Within hours, however, the story was changed. The public was told a mistake had been made, and the crashed object was nothing more than an ordinary weather balloon.
Despite testimonies of scores of reliable witnesses who have since come forward, the official stand today, nearly 50 years later, is still that it was just a military weather balloon. A new Air Force investigation announced its findings just weeks before this broadcast.
It wasn't a UFO. That's what the Air Force is saying after an 8-month investigation of a crash near Roswell, New Mexico, a crash that occurred 47 years ago. For years, there have been stories passed along by the residents that what the Air Force called a weather balloon was really a UFO, and that there were extraterrestrials on board. The Air Force tracked down people, combed archives, and even sent some old news photos to the CIA for analysis. It concluded what other government agencies had concluded for many years. There was no conspiracy to hide the truth.
The amount of dissenting opinion is almost overwhelming among those who have investigated the incident and those who were witnesses.
Don Schmidt, author of UFO Crash at Roswell, has painstakingly researched every angle of the Roswell story, including the notion that the Army misidentified a weather balloon as a UFO.
The first press release that it was a flying saucer, and 6 hours later, we're sorry, ladies and gentlemen, there's no threat. There's nothing to be up in arms about. It's just a radar reflector device constructed of foil, balsa wood, and baling twine. Now, even the rancher would have recognized the baling twine, certainly, and the rest of the material very conventional. And the very idea that the rancher, the sheriff, the deputies, the intelligence officer, the base commander, the counterintelligence officers, the engineers at Roswell, nobody could identify foil sticks and baling twine until General Ramey examines the material and it's just a weather balloon. The question is, which press release is the true story? We have over 500 witnesses testifying through sworn affidavit or video deposition that what was recovered out here at this site and at the debris field site just 40 miles from here was not manufactured on this earth.
Bob Shirky is one of those witnesses. As an Army pilot stationed at Roswell, he got a close look at some of the recovered material as it was loaded onto a plane. He remembers the report that it was a flying saucer.
The very next day, there was a recant from 8th Air Force saying that it was a weather balloon that was found and not an unknown object. All I can say to that is that we had weather balloons in base operations because the weather station was there also. And I would see them carry a balloon out, blow it up, and send it on its way with the radios on and so forth. And what was brought through the hangar, through the building, and loaded on the airplane was not the same material. It was not a weather balloon.
One important figure to express skepticism over the continuing balloon story is Congressman Stephen Schiff of New Mexico. His office has initiated its own investigation into the case. He believes official records pertaining to Roswell exist and that these should be made available to the public.
Can you imagine probably the best bomber group in the Army Air Corps saying that a weather balloon was a flying saucer? That would have been quite an embarrassment, and there should be some documentation of that going back and forth in Air Force, then Army Air Corps channels, mm-hmm. about how could this happen? Mm-hmm. You know, how could we make such fools out of ourselves if that is in fact what occurred? And I've asked the General Accounting Office to look for that documentation. I've also suggested they look at something else. There seems to be no doubt that these materials, when picked up, don't seem to have been treated like they were parts of a weather balloon. In other words, it seems to be uncontradicted that these materials were flown out of New Mexico under armed guard by military police. Now, weather balloons are not normally shipped under armed guard, so I've also suggested they look for the records as to who issued instructions suggesting that these materials be guarded at gunpoint. That is not how you'd normally see a weather balloon transported.
Public interest in the Roswell case has reached an all-time high as interest in UFOs in general is rising. Walter Hort was the public information officer at Roswell, whose job it was to issue the official flying saucer press release. Hort's Army experience with public information and UFOs has been called upon more recently. A couple of years ago, he and some partners opened a non-profit UFO museum in Roswell to satisfy a growing curiosity on the subject.
Radar and visual presentation from all 50 states.
Several months ago, the Showtime cable network aired a special two-hour movie about Jesse Marcel, the intelligence officer sent to investigate the crash. Here, the major, played by Kyle MacLachlan, arrives at the debris-strewn ranch belonging to Matt Brazel, played by Dwight Yoakam.
You know those Japanese balloon bombs?
Yeah, made of rice paper, about 30 feet in diameter. They don't come apart when they land unless the bomb goes off. Then you'd see char marks everywhere.
Right. Was this gouge here before?
Nope.
All right. Let's just suppose Los Alamos or White Sands launched some ultra-experimental plane, rocket, or whatever.
They'd be out looking for it.
Maybe they are, maybe they can't find it. That happened.
Sherman, look around you. What do you see? I mean, what do you see geographically? This place may be remote by car, but not by plane. You'd have to be blind not to spot this from the air. Nobody's found anything because nobody's out looking. And that means this ain't ours.
To better understand the significance of the entire Roswell case, let's go back for a moment to early summer 1947. It was less than 2 years after the end of World War II. The troops had come home. America was getting back to work and coming to terms with its new position as a global power. And the Cold War was heating up. In late June and early July, there were a series of strange reports from all over the world. People were seeing unrecognizable objects flying around with inexplicable trajectories. Some appeared to be round disks, others cigar-shaped. And the stories were not just from ordinary citizens. Many reports came from highly trained pilots, both civilian and military. New Mexico at the time was home to a number of highly classified military projects. On the night of July the 4th, the central part of the state was hit by some of the most violent thunderstorms in memory. A rancher named Mac Brazel was one of a number of people who heard a loud explosion amidst the thunder. Investigators have established the sequence of events which then followed. July the 5th. Roswell discovers a huge field of very strange, lightweight metallic debris on his ranch, and the next day he brings it to the sheriff in Roswell. They then report the find to the Army Air Base. On July 7th, Roswell takes Major Jesse Marcel and another officer out to the debris field where they load up some of the material and bring it back to the base. The next morning, troops are sent out to guard the debris field as well as an actual crash site 40 miles away. After Roswell talks to some local radio stations, Colonel Blanchard, the commander of the base at Roswell, dictates a press release saying the Army has captured a flying disc. That afternoon, the story hits the wires, and phone lines in Roswell are jammed. But within hours, Major Marcel is sent to Fort Worth with some of the debris, and there, General George Ramey gives Marcel some remnants of a weather balloon. At a hastily arranged press conference, Ramey says his officers had made a mistake, and the crashed object was in fact nothing more than a weather balloon with an attached radar reflector. And so the case was closed. Everyone moved on to other things. Just 2 months later, the attention of the nation was riveted on Chuck Yeager as the man with the right stuff broke the sound barrier and our own space program was officially underway. Whatever happened at Roswell was quickly forgotten by all, except those who were actually there. One of the most perplexing features of the incident is that the Army at first appeared to acknowledge the existence of an extraterrestrial craft, then completely denied it. Why didn't anyone question the about-face? Those who were there have their own theories.
This was right after the war. I say right after, it was a year and a half, but even so, everyone who'd been in the service during the actual war period had been always told, don't talk to anybody, don't tell them what you're doing, et cetera, et cetera.
I think you've got to take a couple things into consideration. The 509th was a very highly classified organization. They were the only ones in the world capable of handling and delivering an atomic weapon. If you didn't have a need to know, you didn't ask. I was a bombardier, amongst other duties. I never was permitted to go near an airplane that had the bomb racks capable of handling an atomic weapon. I never asked to. I knew that I wasn't supposed to, so that was the end of it. You've got a different frame of mind back in 1947 than you have in 1994.
Frank Joyce was a radio personality in Roswell at the time and spoke with rancher Mac Brazel. He believed national security may have motivated the cover-up.
That was a different era than now. You didn't have the complex society that we have now. You did not have TVs, cameramen as we have scheduled here, a news reporter like yourself with a backing of all sorts of people and all the best equipment in the world to report everything that happened. So when a statement came out on the news wire that simply said it's a weather balloon, people were inclined to believe it. And I don't say these things lightly because I have great respect for our military and was at that time very, as much of a patriot as anyone. And as I said, given the mindset of people at that time, if you told me it was something of national security, I wouldn't talk about it.
Times were indeed different in 1947. This was before the era of Vietnam. The 60s in Watergate had not happened, nor the recent savings and loan scandals. It wasn't yet common practice to question everything the government did. It wasn't until 1978 that the file on Roswell was reopened. Stanton Friedman, a nuclear physicist, author, and popular lecturer, was the person who stumbled upon this extraordinary story.
In the course of my lecturing, of course, because I take such a strong stand, the lecturers, flying saucers are real. I'm not an apologist, ufologist. A lot of people tell me lots of things. And once when I was in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, at a television station, waiting for a third interviewer, and the station manager's giving me coffee because the girl was late, out of the blue, no previous connection, anything we'd talked about, he says, you know, the guy you ought to talk to is Jesse Marcel. Who's he? Oh, well, he handled pieces in one of these saucers when he was in the military. That got my attention, as you can imagine. I said, well, is he alive? Do you know him? Oh, yeah, he lives over in Houma. I hadn't the faintest idea where Houma, Louisiana was then. I've been there since, of course. We're old ham radio buddies. Great guy.
So Friedman began to look into the case, and his findings led to a book, Crash at Corona. Others followed his lead, and one by one, witnesses who had kept silent for over 30 years began coming forward.
Most people connected with Roswell took their cue from the Army and quietly accepted the weather balloon story, including the press.
They staged a launch of a radar reflector from a weather balloon and loudly proclaimed, fantasy of flying disc is explained here. All these pictures deal with this silly little radar reflector on a weather balloon. General Ramey gives the explanation. Next day they stage the launch, the media are there, it goes out on a wire, and that was the end of the flying saucer craziness.
Those who asked questions were told quite directly, don't.
The first release, all that material was taken out. Some of it, I understand, got into papers in other parts of the country off the original release. But I spent about 15 or 20 years not knowing whether that was true or not, because this story was really hushed up. I mean, it was shut up entirely.
Judd Roberts managed the radio station in Roswell where Frank Joyce worked. He recalls that dropping the entire story wasn't a request, it was an order.
I had a call from Washington the next day, right after that, after the news deal had come out, and saying that if we put anything on the air at all, that they were monitoring us, and if there was anything on the air at all, frankly, they'd pull our license. He wasn't talking about a hearing or anything. He said it'll be canceled not later than tomorrow morning.
There are many reports of witnesses being threatened or bullied, or in the case of military personnel, being shipped off to remote locations, all to keep the lid on this story.
Nobody knew about this site except some of the civilians involved, and they were actually threatened into submission. The military went to their homes, they sequestered them at the base and reinforced their oaths of secrecy with physical threats. In other words, you will come to bodily harm if you ever say a word about this.
When people like Stanton Friedman, Don Smith, and others went to federal agencies and began probing, one thing they found was that the US government was anything but cooperative with information.
Back in the late 70s, went after the CIA, everybody's favorite target, you know. We want all your UFO information. We don't have any UFO information. You do too, we do not. We appeal, they deny. We go to court. The judge says, do a search of your files, gentlemen, at the CIA. They come back, oh, we found 900 pages of UFO information. After saying they had none, you understand. I naturally filed with the CIA for their 23 UFO documents. They're supposed to respond in 10 working days. That's pretty quick, and you know what's going on. 35 months later, they responded. They agreed to release the first nine. I was ecstatic until I looked at them. We're talking 23 documents, nine's pretty good. They were press abstracts of Eastern European newspaper articles about flying saucers, which the Russians had the day they were published. Their own 14 documents they withheld. They tried to discourage me from appealing, I appeal. 2 years after that, so it took me 5 years, they agreed to release tiny portions of three of those documents. This is a released CIA UFO document. Very informative. There are about 8 words or so that you can read there, none of which tell you anything.
Though official information is tough to come by, investigators press onward, inspired perhaps by increasing public curiosity.
As time goes by, public interest seems to be anything but diminishing. In fact, it's just the opposite. There appears to be a growing desire by citizens to get whatever information the government has on Roswell.
The popular scientific monthly, Omni Magazine, recently featured a Roswell declaration in which readers were invited to join the petition for any information the government may have. There is an ever-growing pile of books, articles, and videos relating to Roswell. It's clear that people want to know.
So the question is, why are they still withholding all this information? Why the cover-up after all these years?
If you had some sort of a national security situation, people just wouldn't talk about it.
I can't imagine any kind of security need from the year of 1947, which may have been valid then, being still valid almost 50 years later.
What crashed near Roswell was a mystery in 1947. It's no less a mystery today. We join the voices of those who ask that the truth be told. Was it a secret government experiment? Was it a crashed ship from another world? Or was it, as the Air Force says, nothing more than a simple weather balloon? I'm Patrick Macnee. Join me next time for more mysteries, magic, and miracles.